The Bose wave is a phase wave moving with a phase velocity. Quantum energy is given by the equation, and the de Broglie relation is, substituting frequency and wavelength from these two, we get the relation. In a free space where no forces in it, special relativity gives the energy, and the relativistic momentum is, where v here is the speed of the particle itself. Plugging them into the phase velocity relation, we divide by c, and we notice that since the right side is greater than 1, the left side is also greater than 1, which means that the phase velocity is greater than the speed of light. Of course, this should not be surprising or strange to us now. De Broglie's wave, whose speed is v sub p, is not the speed of the particle, but rather appeared as a result of the motion of this particle in front of some observer. The particle itself, or the inertial frame of reference associated with it, moves with a speed v that's always less than the speed of light due to its mass. Thus, we as external observers of the particle must distinguish two things, the particle itself and the phase wave it exhibits due to its motion in front of us. This will give the complete representation of the particle's dynamics. The phase wave in empty space can be represented mathematically by a plane wave. It's given by the relation, and it moves, as we said, at this phase velocity. But what about the particle itself? Do we describe it as a point particle, as in classical physics? If we did that, how would we relate this representation to the wavelength of the associated wave that we also observe with the particle? We must find a function or a mathematical representation that achieves a balance between these two aspects, wave and particle, and any particle representation must also reflect the wavy property. We might expect the wave part to be in this form, a sine wave, which is the wave associated with the particle and corresponds to de Broglie's wave. But what about the particle part? Mathematically, the problem is as follows. This is the wavelength axis, and corresponds to it here is the k value axis, the wave numbers. We now select two k values or wavelengths from this axis. Then we sum the two sine functions corresponding to these two plane sine waves. Using a trigonometric identity, we find that the function of psi becomes. Note that the second parameter, or the second factor, is the rapid oscillatory sine factor, and its speed is omega over k, where k and omega are the average k value and the average frequency of the two sine waves. The first factor now modifies this second factor. It's also a sinusoidal function, but its speed is given by the differences. If we plot this now, we get a train of wave packets. Note that the wavelength of the sine function is this. Again, it's the average value of the waves included in the sum. But we have not yet achieved what we want completely. The particle property requires greater localization. Therefore, this time we'll reduce the difference between the wavelengths we choose, meaning we'll reduce delta k, and we will also increase their number to see what we get. Since delta k is now small, we can call it small dk, meaning it's now infinitesimal. So the sum turns into an integral, an integration of sine waves. Let the range of k values be from 0 to some value k sub m. If we integrate, we will get this function now. Now notice that k sub m represents the range width of the k values taken into integration. If we take, for example, the value of k sub m equals 1, meaning that we include all values of k from 0 to 1, we get the following figure. Let's expand the k range even more. Let's take k sub m equals 3. Notice that the pattern becomes narrower. What if we take the value k sub m equals 100? The pattern becomes narrower still. Thus, as shown, we have fulfilled the condition that the particle must be within some position range. And at the same time, we have associated the wave property with it. These vibrations inside have a wavelength that's the average of the wavelengths we have included in the integration, and it's de Broglie's wavelength. Erwin Schrödinger was the one who proposed this method to represent the quantum particle. Note that the pure wave function, or de Broglie's wave, requires that there must be some width in this strong pattern, and that's important. If you have noticed or not, we have already reached Heisenberg's principle of uncertainty. This inverse relationship between the width of the wave packet in position space and the width of the range of k values in k-space is the mathematical representation of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. In fact, it's a necessary relationship that appears automatically as long as the wave function or the mathematical representation of this particle includes now the wave property, which it must do, of course. Each of the plane waves we combine to form a wave packet represents a wave of a completely determined k-value or wavelength. Quantum mechanics is a physical mathematical theory that tells an observer what to expect if he or she makes a measurement. If we collect a large number of plane waves, delta k will increase in width, but delta x will narrow. That is, the more k-values or lambda values we include, the more uncertain the momentum is, and at the same time, the less the x-values and the more certain particle's position will be. This wave nature involved in describing the quantum particle imposes now limits on our knowledge. If the wave packet was of some width in space, then we as observers or as people who want to measure its position won't be able to say exactly where the particle is. Is it here, here, or here? All what the theory allows us to know, or actually all what's there to know, is the probability distribution of the particle's location. In the middle of the wave packet, the probability is much higher than at the tails. This does not mean that we will definitely detect the particle in the middle. This brings us back to what we mentioned in video 6 when we defined de Broglie's wave and its importance, and said that if the dimensions of the studied system is of the order of de Broglie's wavelength, then its quantum wave properties will be high prominent, which imposes limits on our knowledge, and the probabilistic nature of the theory becomes an unavoidable reality to us as observers of the real world. To further see how deeply the wave mechanics are inherent in a quantum particle, let's turn to de Broglie's to see what it tells us in the case of a wave packet. P equals h over lambda. As we know now, this lambda is the wavelength of the inner phase wave of the packet. P equals mass times velocity, the particle's velocity. H and m are just constant, and we may for now set them to 1 using some appropriate units. We then have V equals 1 over lambda. I made this simple demonstration in Desmos, and I used in it what's called a Gaussian wave packet, given by this function. If we let time pass, the wave packet moves forward. By changing the de Broglie wavelength of the inner wave, we can make the particle move faster or slower. Longer wavelength means a slower particle, and vice versa. But is this new to us? Aside from the formula itself, we have saw in video 5, and if you haven't come across it yet, you should go and watch it. The de Broglie's wave is the result of the Lorentz transformations we applied to a pure temporal periodic phenomenon exists in the frame of reference of the particle. Thus we get, in the frame of reference of some outer observer, a periodic phenomenon that has also a spatial extension, not only a temporal one. Hence, the phase wave of de Broglie arises. In the frame of reference of the particle itself, the wavelength is infinite, meaning just doesn't exist. But in the observer's frame of reference, the greater the velocity of the particle moving in front of him, the shorter the wavelength Lorentz transformations yield. Actually, the momentum of the particle is now encoded by this inner wave of the particle. So this representation of the particle agrees very well with what we know from videos 5 and 6. If we now put the mass, a Planck's constant, back into the equation, then the wavelength becomes, in general, very small. Actually, this extremely tiny value of Planck's constant is the main reason why quantum mechanics wasn't realized before. Imagine now we make the mass of the denominator large. The wavelength and all of the wavy properties get entirely negligible. Whatever the speed of an object might be, slow or fast, when the mass increases to some micrograms, grams, or even to kilograms, the wavelength of de Broglie get really, really minuscule. The wave packet that holds this wave also scales accordingly. And so, the location of the particle becomes more determined, and the measurements turn to be more deterministic for such heavy objects. Of course, elementary particles like electrons won't have such masses because they will be something else. Big objects are composed of many particles, and the de Broglie wavelength for them is the average of all these particles. In the next video, I'll explain all of the mathematical structure till entanglement so that you have a complete idea about the theory. Please kindly subscribe and follow the channel. Thank you.